What we're going to do here is examine more of the vocabulary that goes along with experiments. And specifically, we want to talk about what happens when we want a controlled, randomized experiment. Because if we have a controlled, randomized experiment that's well designed, that's very valuable because then when we get to a conclusion and seeing results, we can claim cause and effect. We can say that if we saw some result, this thing caused this thing. So we're going to look at our chia seeds and their effect on weight loss. So chia seeds have become used as a diet supplement, and we have this one study in 2009 where they recruited 38 men and divided them randomly into two groups, a treatment and control, and then they also recruited 38 women and did the same separation randomly. One group was given 25 grams of chia seeds twice a day, and the other group was given a placebo. The subjects volunteered to be part of the study. Now, this is important to note that they are volunteers, since that could bring through some voluntary bias. However, running experiments, you have to have volunteers. You can't force people to be part of an experiment. We do have free will. So with that, we'll want to make note of that mentally, that there might be some voluntary bias, but we can move forward with trusting our data since they're bringing through so many other controlled factors. After 12 weeks, the scientists found no significant difference between the groups in appetite or weight loss. So, first thing we want to talk about are treatment groups. Now, treatment groups should be part of our experiments, and they are the group that's actually receiving the treatment that they're using. So for us, it would be half of those 38 men. So we had 19 men and 19 women that are in the treatment group, and they're receiving 25 grams of chia seeds 2 times a day. So that right there is our treatment group, made up of 19 men and 19 women, receiving those 25 grams of chia seeds per day, twice per day. Then we have the control group. Now the control group is not receiving the treatment. So this would be the 19 men and 19 women not taking chia seeds. That would be our control group. They're not receiving the treatment that we're interested in. Then what we want to talk about is blinding, whether the experiment is single or double blind, and also whether or not a placebo has been used. Now for blinding, if it's single blind, this is telling us about who knows about the placebo, or specifically who knows about the separation of control versus treatment group. If we have a single blind study, that's when the subjects don't know which group they're in. So the subjects don't know if they're taking chia seeds or the placebo, which is very important. If we have a placebo at work, we need to be at least single blind. Double blind is even better for experiments because this is where subjects and the researchers don't know. So what this does is it's important for the subjects not to know so that they don't know whether or not they're taking the placebo. Because if they know they're taking the placebo, that ruins the chance of the placebo effect occurring. It's also nice to have the researchers not know so that any kind of unconscious favoring of the treatment group or focusing on the treatment group a little bit more, it's better if they don't know who's in which group so that they treat everyone equally. So in the description above, they don't state any of these specifically, but what we do have is a placebo. They did tell us that they're giving the control group a placebo. So has a placebo been used? Yes. And has blinding been used? Well, for using a placebo, we should have at least a single blind study. So that's kind of an assumption based on the fact that we have a placebo, but they didn't state anything specifically about how they're running the experiment. If we could design the experiment ourselves, we'd want this double-blind scenario. That brings in so much more control and takes away any bias that the researchers could possibly have. Has random assignment been used? This comes from the fact of how were the treatment groups and control groups formed, and the key is that they divided those groups randomly into the control and treatment groups. So, yes, random assignment was used based on how the groups were separated. Random assignment is very important. It creates diversity within each of the groups. Then the treatment and control groups. If we didn't use random assignment, if we let them choose, or if we separated them based on some factor, we're letting lurking variables come in. But if we use random assignment without any bias to it, then it creates these diverse groups with different factors and different characteristics, and that's what we want when comparing the treatment and the control groups. So random assignment is very important for our experiments. Has blocking been used? Now, blocking is the separating of the groups by some characteristic. Separation of groups by some characteristic. And in this case, we did use blocking. What we did is we carried out a separation at the beginning of men and women. So yes, blocking was used. It was done by gender. Blocking is nice, especially in terms of health. Men and women tend to respond to things differently, so it'd be nice to have that separation of the two, and so that we can just kind of analyze what happened with women versus what happened with men. It's not required for every single randomized experiment, but if it's beneficial, it's a good idea to do it. The response variable is what we want to measure, and in terms of the wording above, what they were looking at is the effect on appetite or weight loss. So maybe they were measuring appetite daily, which maybe, and they didn't state this, but it could have been the calories were being tracked, so their daily, what they were eating daily, how many calories they were eating, that could kind of tie to appetite. And then for weight loss, they were probably tracking weight, so in pounds, to see how their weight changed throughout the study. So can we generalize the conclusion to the population at large and concluding causation? So in terms of causation, we have a very well-designed, controlled, randomized experiment. And how we can tell that is these different factors, the key ones being that we used random assignment is important. We should have some form of blinding and a placebo at work, and this random separation of a treatment group and control group. Having those pieces make it a well-designed, controlled experiment, which means we can claim causation. So we can make some statement about cause and effect. In terms of projecting this to our population at large, yes. However, there may be that voluntary bias. That's the only thing we'd want to be careful of here. And this works great if just, I mean, in terms of these sections of our coursework, you can explain these. You could say, yeah, sounds good to project it to the population, but we should note that they're all volunteers, so there may be some bias. You can use explanation here to expand further on your claims. But these are the key pieces, especially these yellow highlighted ones. If you're designing a randomized experiment, you want to have those factors as a part of the design if you want to make claims about causation.